Hello, everyone. Welcome to Off the Podium. I have Jaime Martín with me, and he's somewhere in Europe. Welcome to Off the Podium.
Hi, how are you?
Doing well, thank you. So where are you now? What city are you in?
Well, I am in London. I am at home in London. I am from Spain, so my parents still live in Spain, north of Spain, Santander. But I live in London. I have been living here for some time. My wife is English, and that was the reason I came to London some time ago. My wife plays the bassoon.
Oh, wow.
She's the principal bassoon of the London Symphony Orchestra. And in my past life, when I was a flute player, I came to live in London after I finished my studies in Holland. And you know, this is what I've been doing most of my life, basically, to play the flute in orchestras in London.
Wow. And I was going to say, I did read that you played the flute. What made you transition from the flute to conducting?
Well, you know, it is when I went to study in Holland, I went, I think I was 18, 19, when after finishing my studies in Madrid, I went to The Hague. I went to study flute with Paul Verheij, who was at the time principal flute of the Conservatoire Orchestra. And already at that time, I was very keen about the idea of conducting. Don't ask me why. I think, you know, I really loved music very much. I still love music, but at that time I was completely fanatic, probably more fanatic than now. And I was thinking about music all the time. And even when I was 13, 12, I remember myself walking in the street, singing through symphonies and somehow moving my arms with the music. I don't know. The fact is that I was interested in the conducting. When I went to Holland, I started also, I put myself into the conducting class, although what I wanted to do was flute. And somehow, you know, I think that the reason I wanted to go into the conducting class is because I had the romantic idea that the conducting class was going to be a wonderful room where you go and talk about music in a way you've never talked before. You know, at that time, of course, in The Hague, I was doing history and analysis, and you do all this harmony and all these things. But actually, I never had a teacher there who would say to me things like, Jaime, can you look at Beethoven too? And let's talk why here is a forte piano and why here is a scherzato. I don't know, things like that. And somehow I thought the conducting class was going to be that room where we were going to talk about the magic things behind a musical score. Anyway, so I went to that class full of, I was heavily excited about it. And on the first day, we were asked to stand on top of chairs and move our arms like pendulums or things like that. And I really started thinking, this is the most silly thing I've ever been, ever. Because at that time, I mean, probably now I would think differently because now I am conducting. But at that time, I really thought the conducting is nothing to do with arms moving. It was to do about music. Actually, I still think the same. But so actually, after 1.5 months, I left the conducting class. So that was it. So that was my. So I was not interested about that at that time. And then I left it. I really thought, I mean, the reason I was interested in conducting at that time is I thought this was going to help me to understand music in a different way. Mm. But so that was my first contact with wanting to be a conductor, but I was very lucky with in my life as a musician, because from that time I was studying in Holland, Then I became a member of the European, at that time it was called the European Union Youth Orchestra, European Community Youth Orchestra, ECYO. Now it's called European Union Youth Orchestra, of course. And so this was in 1998 or 1997. And the conductor of the first project I did with that orchestra was Claudia Bado. With Chamber, Gurelieder, with Claudia Bado conducting, Jesse Norman singing. I mean, it was incredible. And suddenly there I was, all Spanish flute players there. At that time, we were only two or three Spanish people because, you know, in Europe, all the big music tradition was coming from Germany, England, Italy, France, Spain. We were only three people there. And suddenly I thought, wow, this is amazing, you know, to be here playing with Claudia Bado, Chamber Gurelieder. This was like, this is an amazing experience.
Yeah.
The following tour was with Subin Mehta. We went to India with Subin Mehta conducting Ravi Shankar, Genesitar Concerto, Mahler One, Leonora Free. And if I had at that time any wish to become a conductor, then suddenly it went, because I thought, if I am a conductor, I will never play with these people again. And I was having a ball working with conductors like that. So soon after, then I started getting jobs in orchestras. So I got, for 1 year, I became like, I had a contract with the Netherlands Philharmonic Orchestra. Then later I got a job with the Residential Orchestra in The Hague. And then I moved to London because the London Symphony Orchestra started asking me to play principal flute because they were looking for people. Then I got a job with the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields. I was a principal flute with that orchestra for many years. Then became the principal flute of the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra at the time when Daniele Catti was the conductor. Then Chamber Orchestra of Europe, when both Claudio Abbado was conducting, and then Nikolaus Harnoncourt was starting to do all these Beethoven amazing projects. So I was in the middle of all that, playing the flute. How could I become a conductor then? I mean, I was in, you know, I had such fantastic time working with all these amazing people and talking to them, you know, because I was curious about conducting. I always had a big connection with them and asking questions. But at that time, I didn't know that at some point I was going to make the jump.
Wow. Well, actually, let's jump to the current situation. COVID-19, everything that's happening in the world of music. And it's so tough because I talk to artistic administrators and I talk to music directors, and it's so tough to think into the future, what to do with the future, and also what to do with all those canceled programs. So what are your plans? What are you going to do with all those canceled programs? Are you going to re-engage some of those programs and some of those artists? What's the future? What are you thinking?
Well, everybody's thinking about exactly the same situation. As you can imagine, all the work I was supposed to be doing for the last month and into the next few months has been canceled. For instance, today, Monday, I had to start rehearsing Shostakovich 4 with the Spanish radio orchestra. And of course, people in lots of orchestras, they don't want to use the word cancellation. Because so then they say, okay, we'll postpone that. But of course, next season is full.
Yeah.
So it is postponed to sometime in the future, which probably maybe it will be in 2 years' time. So I have no doubts that they will try to get dates with me and maybe to recreate the same program with the same soloist or whatever. But some orchestras, for instance, my orchestra in Sweden is trying to postpone as many of the concerts that we have to be doing now in the next few months for next season. But this is not always practical, because actually if you move things from May now until you move that to let's say, next November. That means you have to cancel whoever you booked, whoever was the soloist. So probably the best solution for these programs or these soloists you engage this season is to talk to them and say, look, let's try to do this, not next season, but the following season when maybe the plans or the bookings are still not completely confirmed.
Yeah.
At the moment, what we have to think in a very optimistic way is that everything will happen as planned from September or October. Deep down in the back of our minds, we know that this is not going to happen. I think yesterday the mayor of LA said that possibly will not be any sport events or music events until 2021. But of course, the thing is that we have to play it by ear, I think.
Yeah.
I think this is a time to be very flexible. And once we get away from this shock, then to start being very creative about the following months. I mean, the next few months, they are canceled. That's it. What is going to happen next season? It is going to be... it is a complete in the air. You know, I'm talking with the orchestra. I work in LA, Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra. And we have some beautiful plans for next season. So our intention is to try to do as much of that as possible. But it is so difficult, so difficult. And I think music, sports, anything to do, anything that needs an audience. I think it's going to be we are going to suffer a lot.
Yes.
You know, we will go back to work. We will be the last one.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I have a question for you. Every day I wake up with a different mood. You know, sometimes I am terribly pessimistic, sometimes I am very optimistic, you know, about what's going to happen. When I am optimistic, I feel or I imagine a world after this pandemic and after so many months of people being at home, and then I imagine a world where people want to be together again and go out and share experience of being to a concert, to a theater, to a restaurant. But when I am pessimistic, I think, my God, everybody is going to be very afraid to be together and they will not want to do anything. What do you think is going to happen? As a society, how we are going to react at the end of this? With fear or with a celebration of humanity and togetherness and human contact?
I feel the same way you do a lot. It depends on the day, really. But I have a positive attitude, and I hope that after all of this, you know, staying at home, people will be eager to go out and experience the live concert, because there's absolutely nothing like experiencing a live concert when you're in the moment, in the hall, feeling the people who are around you, and you're listening to the music live with might be some wrong notes in there or some imperfections, but it's just an amazing experience to be in the concert hall and be surrounded by so many people. So I hope that after all of this, people will flood the concert halls and be more enthusiastic about listening to live music. Very important, because as classical musicians, or even in jazz, I think a lot of people rely on the live concerts. You know, when you, I think even with sporting events, even though they rely on the big audiences to be there for the event, and it gives a different atmosphere when you're in this big stadium and Real Madrid is playing, and the greatest teams in basketball and soccer. But I think sports could sort of survive if this continues. But I don't think classical music and jazz will have as many options. I'm a little bit scared, but I'm trying to stay positive.
The thing is that I think we all feel exactly the same. And one of the things I am, of course, I am at home. with my family, which is great, so we have time to be together. But one of the things I really miss is this interaction. You know, I love going to the theater. I love going to the cinema. I love going to concerts, going to opera. I love going to exhibition. I love this kind of thing, and this is what I really miss now. And I think there is something about the life, any kind of life, that I find completely irresistible. You know, you can watch in film, in Netflix, and that's wonderful. But for me, it's this moment when you are sitting in the cinema and suddenly the lights go out, and it's dark, and then zoom, suddenly this amazing screen full of light. I think that kind of moment is magic, the same as in the concert. You know, the orchestra is there, the A is played by the old one. The moment the first chord an orchestra makes, doesn't matter how many times you have heard the same orchestra, but for me to go to a concert and to hear the first actual sound, boom, I find that completely thrilling. Mm-hmm. I feel the same going to a soccer match. I love going to the stadium and suddenly it's so green. I don't know. It's something about being in the place that you cannot recreate.
Yeah.
In any way. And of course, during this time, you know, I think things are getting a little bit more. We are getting a bit more used to the situation, and of course we are still depressed and thinking about how much people are suffering and all people around us, and we are thinking about the uncertainties about the future. But with musicians, I've noticed something quite extraordinary. It's all this, suddenly everybody is recording Bach suites from the kitchen. So, or lots of things which I find very sweet, but there was a moment that was almost too much.
I thought
it was like, oh my god, it's like and I was a little bit worried at that time, you know, when I saw so much of that, because I was thinking about, oh, shall I do that, shall I record something with my flute, with my phone, but you know, my phone sounds terrible, you know. I don't have a proper microphone here, and of course I can play. I mean, it really sounds really not very nice.
Yeah.
So I think we have to be a little bit more creative than that.
Yeah.
You know, and I think we have to find a way to still have a relationship with our audience and to know that we are there, of course. But there is lots of music there. You know, if you want to listen to Mahler 1, you can listen to Mahler 1 Spotify or on your CDs or on YouTube or I don't know, or in the digital concert hall.
Yeah.
1 million ways you can. Music is still there.
Yeah.
And music has always been there.
Yeah.
But we have to find a way to make people excited to go back to the concert hall whenever we are there. Again, in the concert hall, but I don't know. I have a bit of mixed feelings about this sudden invasion of offerings by lots of people, which I find very nice as a one-time thing, you know. Or in some cases, I really love that. I mean, so I am very mixed. For instance, Igor Levy was doing a concert every day in his house, and I thought that was lovely, because you know that at 7 o'clock you can go and listen to play a concert. I thought that was wonderful, but at the same time there are lots of, I mean, but he did a beautiful sound with his piano, you know. I think probably he had a nice microphone. I am afraid of things that are not the best quality. I don't know if it will be in the long term good or not so good.
And I talked to actually someone who said exactly the same thing that you're saying, is my past guest just a couple of days ago. I had this famous jazz pianist, Vijay Iyer, who was my guest, and he said a lot of the similar things you're saying, which is there are a lot of recordings, and he's very hesitant about putting his live stuff out there, and he's sharing a lot of his past recordings and all the stuff that he's done in the past and other people's recordings that were done in the past. So he was saying a lot of the similar things with not great quality home equipment and all this stuff. So it's nice to hear that two artists are sharing the same thoughts.
Well, I don't know. The thing is that probably there are as many. The thing is that I understand all that because we are all worried and we are all missing. We are all missing doing it. But I think what we have to do is to try to create the expectation for or something for the future. You know what people are missing.
Yeah. Well, I like to say I have two hometowns. My hometown, my birth town, is Yerevan, Armenia, and my adopted hometown, I guess, is L.A. And so, and you work with the L.A. Chamber Orchestra, and I know they do a lot of wonderful stuff for the community. They do a lot of amazing things for youth and education, which I'm very passionate about. I work with youth orchestras. So tell me a little bit about L.A. Youth Orchestra. What are the various projects or what's hopefully to come up in the upcoming season if things go smoothly and things get started?
Well, with this season that started in September was my first season as music director of Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra. So what an accidental season to start. I mean,
yeah.
At least I have done four of my planned six concerts this year with the orchestra. So in that sense, I feel lucky, and I feel also that I had a bit of time to get to know the audience and to see how the city works. Of course, I think that's very important to program for the future of an orchestra. I think to program. To create the program for an orchestra or the type of projects that you want to do, I think for that you need time to get to know the city, to get to know the people. But actually, the one thing I am completely fascinated by LA is how incredibly big and how incredibly dispersed and how incredibly diverse. I mean, you know, I am used to cities where you can sort of, if not walk, then you can take public transport and go from A to B in a reasonable amount of time. I mean, in LA, to go from A to B is like almost going from one country to another in Europe. I mean, it is quite an extraordinary city. And the one thing, I am Spanish, so Spanish is my first language, as you can hear, but LA is a city that I think has the biggest cultural range of any place I know. You know, you have the Latino, the Hispanic community, which is huge. But then, actually, you're Armenian. You know, Glendale is a fantastically Armenian place. I mean, if you want Armenian food, you go to Glendale. That's amazing. The Korean community in LA is huge. The Japanese community is huge. I mean, there is incredible. I mean, I think it is amazing how a city can be so embracing. And I find amazing how everybody respects everybody else. You know, somehow, at this time, when from some of the politicians, they are trying to create hatred or immigrants, and they don't want foreigners. And actually, you look at LA and you don't feel that. It's almost like some people are trying to create that sense of not being happy with each other. And I think LA is a celebration of togetherness in that sense. I'm thinking about that, you know, when I had time during this year to go and visit some of the fantastic projects in the communities, you know, like music education for adults that come from complicated backgrounds. And when I say complicated backgrounds, you know, I was talking to this guy learning to play the guitar. He just came the week before, he just left jail, and he had been in jail for 20 years or something like that. I mean, something that seems completely unimaginable for most of us. And this person started crying when I was talking to him and about things. And he said, oh, I am discovering music, I'm discovering playing the guitar, and I am so excited every week I come here. And I have met lots of people that have inspired me a lot. So that's why, you know, for the first concert of the season, we were planning to do, of course, this year is the Beethoven year, as everybody in the world, like music or not, is aware of. And there is lots of Beethoven. And actually, because of that, we wanted to do Beethoven Symphony Number 9 to open the season. But not just because it's a wonderful piece of music. I think we wanted to do Beethoven 9. I wanted to do it because of the text of Schiller in the last movement of the symphony, you know, when he's talking about all people are equals and everybody together. And for that, we had this project that should have been running through these few months, starting in January, all the way until September. But of course, we had to stop it because school. But in the end, what we're going to do, and we are hoping still to do in September, is to create a huge choir made from different community choirs in LA.
Wow, okay.
Armenian, the Korean, the Japanese, the gay choir, the gospel choir, to put all of these choirs together with a wonderful chorus master, which is going to be Jenny Wong, and then every member of these different choirs. We want them to be on the stage with their uniforms of their own choir. So we want the stage to be full of people wearing different colors, different clothes, different things, and sing together, not sing, but shout for freedom. So this was going to be our first concert. And in that program, in the first half, our composer in residence and artistic creative, Helen Reed, was going to, she's actually writing a piece to play in the first half of that concert. So I was really looking forward to that. And I am sure that one way or another we will be able to do this project. If not in September, maybe a bit later. But I think it's worth fighting for that. And we were developing an education project with schools in LA based on school kids creating a poem inspired by the Schiller poem. And once they create their own poem or their own text, that in mind of all people together, then Derek Spiva, one of our composers associated to the orchestra, was going to help them to create a piece related to their poem. So the whole thing was going to be a big project lasting a year. I know we had to stop, which is a shame. But yeah. Anyway, this was going to be our first concert. And actually, we had fantastic plans of things. I mean, to do, I was looking forward to do a concert with Jeff Kahane, who has been the music director of the orchestra for more than 20 years. So in our second program, I was going to conduct. And Jeff was going to play the Emperor Concerto, Beethoven. And in the second half, we were going to play Brahms Symphony Number 2. And I really was looking forward to... Well, actually, I am... Let me see. This is in November. So, fingers crossed. We might be able to do it. I want to... You know, I would love so much to be on the stage with my colleagues and friends of Leiko, together with Jeff, that has been so important for them. And, you know, the months following that, we were going to have Jill Saham playing the Tchaikovsky Violin Concerto. Then we were going to have Nemanja Radulovic, which is an amazing Armenian violin player. No, he's not Armenian. Nemanja Radulovic is Serbian. he's Serbian, he's not Armenian. And he was going to do his LA debut. He is a fantastic violin player. I've done lots of work with him in Europe. He has a contract for Deutsche Grammophon. He's done wonderful things, but he's never been in LA. And I was looking forward to the Prokofiev second violin concerto with him in LA. But I really hope, when I talk about this project for next season, I really hope that we can do it. It will be such a shame. But, you know, if we have to move it to the following year or a few months later, then we will all try.
Yeah. Well, you talked about premieres. I want to hear your thoughts. Why is new music important? And I know you're involved very much with premiering lots of works with LA Chamber Orchestra and all over the world, really. Why is it important to program new music and new composers and living composers?
I think it is important because we have to be challenged.
Yeah.
You know, I think we could be talking for a very long time about this, but I really believe that there is a generation of composers now that I have met in LA, and actually in Europe I have met lots of composers that I would put inside that group. Lots of composers now, young composers, that are trying to find a way to write music, keeping in their minds that they are writing music for people. And with this, I am not criticizing anything that has happened before, but there was a time, when I was a student, that for me, lots of modern music was almost like an intellectual exercise, which was wonderful, if that's what you were looking for. But sometimes not something you really wanted to hear too much. Yeah. I am not critical. You have to take what I'm saying with a pinch of, not incredibly literal, but I really think that some of the composers I am meeting now, they are writing music that is incredibly challenging, interesting, but at the same time makes the audience curious about it, and they want to hear more, but not just because they think they should, but because they want.
Yeah.
and you know, I think when I was saying to you before that there have been composers that in a way have scared the audience. And I think I have to criticize some composers for that. It was becoming a little bit like, you write a galactic piece of music that incredibly complicated to listen, incredibly complicated to perform, and very often the audience would not want to hear that again. And so, I think this kind of approach to new music has made the audience very afraid for many years.
Yeah.
And, you know, we started this season with a new piece by Andrew Norman, which I think is a wonderful composer, and the audience loved it. And I have been, recently, I've been doing premieres of pieces that, you know, in the first half, when the audience would stand up after the piece was finished. You know, rather than the polite few seconds clap and goodbye and thank you, and we feel, okay, we've ticked a box, we've done something modern. I think it is very important to program new music, not as a box-ticking exercise, but as in believing that we are introducing to the audience to something worth listening.
Mm. Well, a couple more questions. I don't want to take too much of your time. It's been really fun, but a life-changing moment for you, whether it's a musical moment or just a personal, non-musical moment, life-changing moment.
For me, musically, life-changing moment was to work for the first time with Harnoncourt, with Chamber Orchestra of Europe. You know, Harnoncourt has been a controversial artist, and some people like it, some people don't like the way he makes music, but it was life-changing, because before I worked with him, I heard some of his recordings, and I didn't like them very much at some point. I thought, I remember listening to the Pastoral Symphony before I ever played with him, and I thought, oh, this is all very fussy. I mean, every time what we are used to play short, he does long. And I think he just did it to be different. You know. So I remember I was a little bit almost angry when I listened to Pastoral Symphony for the first time with him. Anyway, then I went to work with him, and I remember we were in Graz in Austria, and we were performing the Prague Symphony, which we recorded from the live concert, and we were doing Schumann Symphony number 3 and 4 in the same week. We were recording also for the Teldec Schumann cycle. And I could not believe the rehearsals. You know, I was there, and for 15 years I worked with Harnoncourt every year. And the amazing thing with Harnoncourt, and that's why it changed my life, is that everything he said, and often his rehearsals, we didn't have very, very much chance to play. We played very little. We arrived to the concert incredibly scared because we hadn't played very much. But he spent most of the rehearsal talking. I mean, his rehearsals were like a lecture. And you would play something, I remember, and I thought, I am pretty good at this, and I would play something. And he would immediately say, you know, he was not rude, but he would come up with something completely different way of doing it. And more often than not, I felt incredibly stupid, because I thought, of course, this makes so much sense. Why didn't I? And I was angry with myself for not having thought of that before. And I was so incredibly angry with myself. Every time he said something, I said, yeah, of course. Yeah. This is logical. Why? It was something about Harnoncourt that made me realize that you have to look at what is written much more carefully than I did at that time. You know, I think there is something with music that is the music traditions. You do something because it has been done before. Oh, I listened to that recording. Oh, I did that. Oh, yeah, it says that, but, you know, usually it's done like that.
Yeah.
That kind of thing, you know. And well, I don't say that traditions are not good. I mean, in many cases, traditions are good, and they are for a reason. But Harnoncourt was, in that sense, he was... for me, a line-changing moment. And another line-changing moment, I don't know what the things that is so difficult to put, because let's leave it with one, a musical moment. I mean, I'm sure we can go into, you know, having my first baby, or we can go into lots of life-changing moments.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that the other life-changing moment was the first time I heard concert live. Which one? I was 8. Until that moment, I thought music is something that I am not at all. I mean, classical music is not something I am interested. And my father took me to a concert, and the first piece they played in the first half was Czech 5,
wow.
And in the second half was pictures of exhibition, and. When the clarinets and the strings started the opening of Tchaikovsky Symphony number 5, I was in tears. It was amazing. Yeah. I was not prepared for that. I think I was in tears because of the sound of an orchestra live. I was not expecting that. Yeah. I don't know what I was expecting, but suddenly to hear all these sounds. And actually, the opening of Tchaikovsky 5 is not loud or spectacular. It's just soft and sad harmony. But I don't know. I was completely. And from that moment, the next day, I said to my parents, "I really want to learn to play an instrument." Mm. And I wanted to play the violin, but there was no violin teacher in my city at that time. There was. Either piano, guitar, or flute. So I took the flute. But that was for me another life-changing moment, because I discovered something that it was amazing. And this is what we were talking earlier about, the amazing thing of having a live event, live music. You can listen to many recordings, and that's wonderful, but live music, to be there, to see somebody in front of you producing these amazing sounds, fantastic.
Yeah. Well, two more questions, and you could give me fast answers if you want, but if we were to open your phone or your computer, whatever you use to listen to music, what would be the last couple of pieces that you heard, or songs, if it's not classical music?
Well, the last few, what I love is to hear Oscar Peterson.
Okay.
Yeah. I like it very much. So yeah. Actually, very often I put that while I cook.
Wow.
That's another thing I love doing. I love cooking to have a bit of jazz. And then lately, I was quite, I like listening to Cuban music.
Okay.
And I've never been to Cuba, or I don't have many Cuban friends. I don't know why. I am really enjoying that.
Yeah. Well, you sort of answered it already, but final question. What is one thing that people who follow your career, your fans, people who know you, don't know about you, but you're willing to share with us today?
Oh, my God. I don't think they know anything about me, really. I don't know what would I want to share. It's funny, because when I am in a place, I don't feel I am hiding anything very much. So then when I make music, I think I just almost lose myself, you know, and I, you know, the it's funny with conducting, and you know, I mean, sometimes I remember somebody, even in the orchestra, when I was in the London Philharmonic, I used to play the flute. I was principal flute in the London Philharmonic, and when I started conducting, then the principal of the orchestra. Well, you know, I went. I remember I went to conduct an orchestra in France, so I asked the orchestra for a week off. I came back to the orchestra the following week on Monday, sitting down, and the principal over here said, "So Jaime, but how do you prepare to conduct?" He said, "Do you look in front of a mirror?" And I couldn't believe he was asking that, because he's a musician, and I thought it was extraordinary that he thought that the conducting, I mean, you know, this is something that has never crossed my mind, to stand in front of a mirror to enjoy my dancing, you know, the one thing With conductors for the audience, you know, they look at a conductor, at somebody in front, you know, standing up, moving. But I never ever think about what movements I am going to, you know, this is the last thing. I mean, all my preparation for conducting is to do with sitting down or with score. I've never, even things like if this would be in 4 or in 8, I don't even think about that.
Yeah.
You know, you just feel when you are with an orchestra, because of course every orchestra is different. Every orchestra needs different things, and then you try to. But I don't know why I'm talking about that. It's because probably I'm saying, what would you? I would like to say to the audience that don't know anything about me that I am trying not to be a dancer when I am on the stage. I am trying to inspire a group of wonderful musicians to do music in a particular way.
Wow. Okay. Well, thank you so much. Thank you for joining me. I hope you have a beautiful day, and I hope that when I'm back in LA visiting, I could also catch one of the LA Chamber Orchestra concerts.
I hope I could see some of your concerts also.
Thank you. Thank you. I hope all of this ends and we're back to back to rehearsals and concerts and all of those things. So thank you.
Let's see. Thank you very much.